Hi, my name is Eoin Cosgrave. I'm a senior scientist here at Waters Corporation. And today I'm going to be discussing the poster where we use UPLC technology for running HPLC-based large molecule applications. Specifically, we look at transferring legacy HPLC peptide mapping methods. So using the H-class for running HPLC methods is an easy way to transition from running legacy HPLC methods into a UPLC environment. So in this example, we've used the H-class bio with HPLC columns. And the one thing that we like to work on specifically is, first of all, focusing on determining the dwell volume differences between an HPLC instrument versus the UPLC difference, because we find that has a very important function and an impact on the chromatography. So what we do here in the first example in figure one is we include the difference in dwell volume between the two instruments. And this is easily adjusted in the instrument method, where you can just select an after injection delay volume. And by doing so, you're able to align the chromatography. And in essence, you can include this isocratic hold step within the instrument method without having to make any other changes to the gradient setup. When we put that into practice, what we find is the results that I've presented here in figure two. In the absence of a gradient delay offset, you see that the chromatographic profiles are different. If you see after we include the isocratic hold offset, we now have the chromatograms aligning. So this is the effect that we would like to see with more complicated profiles. So in figure three, we decided to test this on a more complex peptide mapping method. So to test how this change in the instrument method would actually work on more complicated samples, we decided to trypsinize ribonuclease B and run that tryptic digest using the HPLC method. So this is really a challenge to the method to see if this gradient offset can work on more complicated samples. So here we have in figure three, the top chromatogram is the legacy HPLC instrument chromatogram of a tryptically digested ribonuclease B. And here we've decided to monitor 33 peaks across that profile. When we take that same method and we include the gradient start offset, we find that we get the exact same relative retention times using the H-class bio when we compare it to the legacy HPLC instrument. And that is really quantified here in figure four, where we look at relative retention times. And you can see these two profiles overlay quite nicely. So to use more of the tools available on the H-class bio, we decided to remove our acidic modifier from the mobile phase A and B and instead include it on a third solvent line. So to do this, we used AutoBlend. The reason that we decide to use AutoBlend Plus for controlling the delivery of TFA is that slight adjustments in TFA concentration can have a large impact on the chromatography. And that's really demonstrated in figure five. What we've done here is just adjusted the TFA concentration by 0.01% increments. And you can see in the highlighted boxes within figure five that those subtle changes have a big impact on the resolution of those peaks. When you add acidic modifiers to your mobile phases, tiny adjustments can influence the final concentration of that. To take that variability away, this is why we include it on a third solvent line. When we do this, we get the results of figure six. In this example, we've decided to tryptically digest infliximab, a commercially available monoclonal antibody. In this example, we've tracked 65 different peaks. We've used AutoBlend to deliver TFA as a third solvent line. And what we find when we compare that to the legacy HPLC instrument, we get near identical chromatography. So again, looking at the relative retention times, we see great comparisons between the legacy instrument versus the H-class bio delivering TFA using AutoBlend. But really the goal was to see how the reproducibility would be using AutoBlend, because that's the big challenge for QC labs is reproducibility. So in the example that we presented in figure seven, we find that when we overlay six different injections, it's indistinguishable to find there's no difference between these chromatograms, which is exactly what we're hoping to achieve. Of course, one of the other features that you want when we're looking at chromatography is peak area. So in figure eight, we've looked at the reproducibility of the peak area from six different injections using AutoBlend, and we find that the peak area is excellent in this case. So in conclusion, we've demonstrated here how we can use the Acuity H-Class Bio for running legacy HPLC peptide mapping methods by making a simple adjustment to the instrument method to account for the differences in dwell volumes. We've been able to demonstrate near identical chromatography between two different instruments. When we decide to include an acidic modifier as a third solvent line, we can use AutoBlend to deliver precise measurements of that acidic modifier. This, of course, means that H-Class Bio is a perfect example of an instrument to use for both HPLC legacy methods and, of course, transitioning into UPLC methods in the future. Thanks very much for your attention.